Hello and welcome to Northgate's Advent devotional series, Hope is Coming. I'm Michael Gilmore, and thank you for joining me on this journey as we celebrate the hope that we have in Jesus this season. This devotional series will be a short opportunity for you to dive into the Word, think about what God is asking of you, remind yourself of the hope He has for you, pray, and apply what we're learning together. Today, day one, we're talking about Adam and Eve, going back to the very beginning. Let's read together from Genesis chapter 2. If you have your Bibles, please turn and read along with me. We'll be reading a variety of verses in Genesis chapter 2. Starting in verse 4, this is the word of God. This is the account of creation of the heavens and the earth. When the Lord made the earth and the heavens, neither wild plants nor grains were growing on the earth. For the Lord had not yet sent rain to water the earth, and there were no people to cultivate the soil. Instead, springs came up from the ground and watered all the land. Then the Lord formed man from the dust of the ground. He breathed the breath of life into man's nostrils, and the man became a living person. Then the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he placed the man he had made. The Lord God made all sorts of trees grow from the ground, trees that were beautiful and produced delicious fruit. In the middle of the garden, he placed the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Verse 15. The Lord placed the man in the Garden of Eden and tend and watch over it. But the Lord God warned him, You may freely eat of the fruit of every tree in the garden, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat its fruit, you are sure to die. Verse 21. So the Lord God caused man to fall into a deep sleep. While the man slept, the Lord took out one of the man's ribs and closed up the opening. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib, and he brought her to the man. At last, the man exclaimed, "This is bone from my bone, flesh from my flesh. She will be called woman because she was taken from man." This explains why man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. Now the man and his wife were both naked, but they felt no shame. Chapter 3, verse 1. The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord had made. One day he asked the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees of the garden?" "Of course we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden," the woman replied. "It's only the fruits from the tree in the middle of the garden that we are not allowed to eat." God said, "You must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die." "You won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. "God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil." The woman was convinced. She saw the tree was beautiful, and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were opened, and suddenly they felt shame at their nakedness. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. That was our reading section. And now I want us to take a moment to think about what we just read. What would it be like if you never felt sad? The beginning of creation, all things were perfect and all things were good. What would it be like if you never felt alone or sick or afraid? All of those things are products of the sinful world that we live in. Take a moment to reflect. What would that be like? Eve and Adam were clearly deceived into sinning. But what lies have you believed about God when you sin? Eve was convinced that the tree was beautiful, the fruit was delicious, and it was an opportunity to learn. While many of those things were probably true, they were outside what God intended for them. Just because something is true or beneficial doesn't mean it's what God wants us to be doing. Lastly, how has a temporary pleasure left you disappointed in the end? So many of things that draw us to sinning are temporary pleasures or temporary experiences that tarnish for long after the pleasure is gone. One little lie for your own benefit ends up leading to all kinds of hurt feelings and relationships. One little peek at pornography, one little text to the wrong person, one little lie or gossip can lead to all kinds of things in exchange for just a fleeting moment of superiority. These are all difficult questions to think about and consider, but the hope is that God created Adam and Eve and loved them too much to let them be the end of the story. They were literally just the beginning. God had a plan that one day he would make the world perfect again and rescue his children from the pain and suffering that they caused themselves. Many years later, although it would cause him much suffering, he sent Jesus to die on the cross and pay the price of sin. He did this to bring you back into right relationship with him and invite you into the family of God. If you accept his love forever, one day the Lord will wipe away all of that sin. He'll look upon you and say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." He'll wipe away every tear, he'll cure every pain, and we'll know exactly what it was like to live in paradise the way Adam and Eve did. Well, let's pray together. Father God, thank you for sending Jesus to rescue me from my mistakes. And thank you that those mistakes are no longer counted against me or held against me. Thank you, Lord, that the lies that Adam and Eve believed were not the end of them, of me, or of the world. Help me to believe that you are not withholding good from me, even when you ask me to obey you, and especially when you ask us to obey you. Thank you for all of this, Lord. Amen. Well, I want you to do one last thing, and that's apply what we're learning today. My application challenge for you is to start a thankfulness list. Just start listing the things that you're thankful for and keep going on that list until you have 100 things on that list. There are so many things to be thankful for. I don't think you'll have too much trouble getting that list together. Thankful people are happy people because we're reminded of the good things that God has done for us. Well, there we have it. We read, we thought, we hoped, we prayed, and now we're applying. Thank you so much for joining me this morning. Hope is coming in Jesus Christ, and we're going to continue to discover that in this journey.